Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Boardroom Bites at 9 this morning. Our topic is looking at the latest IRMSA risk report. And we have with us today Christopher Palm, who is the Chief Risk Advisor at IRMSA. And he's going to work through the latest results and let us know what we're currently looking at for the upcoming year. So, Christopher, I'm going to give you control and I'm going to hand over to you now.
Keshni, thank you very much. Good morning to everybody. And again, thank you to the IOD inviting IRMSA to present and share what I believe is a magnificent document in as far as supporting our country in identifying, and secondly, suggesting some good information on how to deal with the risks that face South Africa. So thank you for that. And we are delighted to be part of the Boardroom Bites initiative of the IOD. So I would like this morning, we've got basically an hour to share with you a couple of things. And I would like to first start off by giving you a little bit of background on why the South Africa Risk Report, how did it come about, and why is it important that we as IRMSA provide the country with such a document. Secondly, I would then very quickly like to put the report in a nutshell for you so that we look at what have we learned, what came out of the report, so that you don't have to drink the whole bottle of salt water to realize it's salty. So very quickly looking at that, I want to spend a minute or three just highlighting the IRMSA scenarios that we develop. I think it's critical so that you understand why we had done that, given that there are some really strong already developed scenarios for our country. And then lastly, I would spend time just taking you through the risk profile of the country. Of course, we only have by now about 55 minutes left, but the point that I would like to make is to show you the 12 and highlight one or two of those. And of course, we will circulate the presentation afterward and you will find the complete set of risks as part of the presentation under backup slides as well. So just going on to why the South Africa Risk Report, just a quick reflection on a personal experience. Some years back when I was still young and attractive, I'm just attractive now, but be that as it may, I thought I was so special and I ended up, maybe that was a little bit vague. I ended up in front of a board, and at the time, I'm talking many years back now, and at that time, the best global view of risk, the best continental view of risk, even if you want to think at that level, was the World Economic Forum. And I thought to myself, you know, this is going to be great as setting the context for my risk report. And as chief risk officer walking into the boardroom, I presented this very well crafted, probably bordering on plagiarized presentation around what the World Economic Forum released. And I'm now talking 2005, 2006. And at the end of my presentation, the chairman of the board said to me, Chris, excellent copy and paste skills, but this absolutely means nothing to us at the southern tip of Africa. As a board that needs to make decisions in the context of South Africa, this does not help us. So rethink this approach. And as you would know, setting the context before we start risk identification or risk assessment is of utter importance for effective risk management. And so at the time, IRMSA responded to that request, and initially it became a by the members for the members. But being the seventh edition, this is no longer true. We have people, a global audience as far as the South Africa Risk Report goes. It is a value proposition, not just for the risk practitioner. Initially, we started off saying, we need a South Africa Risk Report.
Hi, everybody. I think Chris is frozen. If you just put in the chat, if you're seeing him frozen as well. Yes. Okay, great. I think we've just lost Chris. If you can give us a few minutes and we'll try and get him back. I think his connection might have lost him. I'm just going to play some music in the meantime. Apologies for this. And you find out if you do that. Welcome back, Chris. Not a problem.
Yes, thank you. And I hope that I stuck to my 1 minute restoration time that I promised Bess.
No worries. We're just keeping everybody occupied with some nice music, and I will continue with that song later when we end. I'm just going to give you control back, Chris, and let me just move on to you. You were on the first slide.
Excellent, thank you. Can I just check everybody can see me and can hear me properly? Thank you. Right. So I was telling you about the experience in the boardroom and where we had a full board around the room and everybody was looking at this excellent presentation around the World Economic Forum, but obviously did not help at all. And so the challenge was for us as the risk profession to step into that breach and to find a way to make boards and to enable boards with a context that allow them to make better decision making. And I think that is why the South Africa Risk Report. It was initially a proposal for our risk practitioners. It was to support the profession, but slowly but surely over the 7 editions, we now in our working on our 8th already, this became a document that is being used across C-suites globally, as well as of course the risk profession. And so the document transforms not just the risk profession in the boardroom, but it also sets a context that allows boards, that allows decision makers, whether you're in the public sector, private sector, whether you're in an SMME, it allows you to make proper decisions. It allows you to understand the context in which you're in. There are 2 challenges though. I mean, we have in the past been on social media criticized that, oh, but all of these risks have materialized. I think that was the one critique. The other critique was, but they're not all relevant to us. Now, of course, some would have materialized in the meantime. Some may have materialized for the country, but not for the public sector. Others for the public sector, but not for the country. So be that as it may, the point is you have to adopt the report and then you have to adapt to that information. Use what is useful. Use that, and of course, what is not, adopt, adapt, and make it useful. And if not, well, then discard that information as well. And then, of course, it has to be our story. And I think that is the last very important point that I want to leave you with here. This has to be about our story. So when you eventually, if you have not yet read the risk report, you have to make this the context of South Africa in which you are operating, maybe as a multinational, even a global or a national business for that matter. So I just needed to share this with you in as far as why do you have a risk report in front of you at the moment. So then I want to move on to the report in a nutshell. So the report in a nutshell is really for us to be able to highlight those issues that you need to focus on when it comes to looking at the report very quickly. So there are a couple of things. Firstly, when we did the report, of course, we had to deal with a pandemic as well. And what we've learned out of this in looking at the report, in unpacking the report, understanding the pandemic in that context, impressed on us the fundamental value, not just of doing risk management, but having effective risk management. I think that's the first thing as a board, whether you're in the public or private space, whether you're an SMME, is effective risk management is really, really important. Secondly, when we consider that you can only change risk by addressing causes, we very, very quickly realized that for specific to South Africa, and I'm not saying we're the only country in the world that has this, but realizing that our geopolitical, as well as our socioeconomic space that we play in, we will forever find it difficult to get the most effective risk responses in place. And I'm spending a little bit of time unpacking this a little bit later, but a very, very key realization for us, which then ties in to a couple of the latter comments as well that I will speak about. The one big thing that stood out is that visionary and ethical leadership is pivotal if we want to own the scenario of South Africa owning its future. And so although we don't rank the 12 risks that we've identified for our country, we do believe that this one is the key driver that we need to focus on. And I'll share a couple of thoughts around that a little bit later. Linking back to the comments I made about geopolitical and the socioeconomic drivers, challenging the risk response strategies. There are no quick fixes for the risks that we've identified. The complexity that we view in relation to the risk responses that we need to put in place to get us from a perpetual hangover into owning our own future will need time. But time needs to be supported by excellent strategy. And if we want to have excellent strategy, we need to have excellent risk management, because risk management is all about the future. And if we do it properly, we will inform excellent strategy. And of course, then the risks associated with the execution of that strategy needs to be supplemented with consequence management. So that was quite an interesting lesson to learn. And you'll ask me now, you'll say, Chris, so where does this come from? Well, I need for you to know, of course, for those that have read the report, our report was influenced by business leaders in South Africa. Jacques Salier, for example, the CEO of First National Bank, Dr. Azad Jamin, he's the director of econometrics, a chief economist there, Nkululeko Nyembezi, chairman of the Johannesburg Stock Exchange, Basisani Moleleko, she was at the time the CEO of African Bank. She's since left there. But then, you know, Suresh Khanna, you will all, the IOD would know Suresh as the chairman of the King Committee. And we even had Jacques Salier's CRO from First National Bank, Latanya Johnson, commenting and adding information to our report, setting context and sharing their experiences, and more importantly, their foresights. And so moving on from there, then, just to look at the last couple of comments I want to share with you around the report, is that there is an obvious change in the corporate and social fabric that we've experienced, and that in relation to all the previous editions that we've released. The world is certainly moving towards a stakeholder-led focus. And I think that is a very important point to make, especially when it comes to setting strategy. Not the execution, the setting of strategy. When boards, executive committees, public sector committees decide on the direction to take organization in, very valuable highlight their current crisis. So from an IRMSA perspective, from the seventh risk report edition perspective, the things that we've highlighted in the past, the current crisis, the things that we're highlighting now, the new threats, the new opportunities, they existed all along. The pandemic just really amplified those, just nearly put the eyeglass on the importance and, of course, on the impact of those risks, of those threats, and those opportunities. Of course, it's timeless for me to say that risk is really threats made up of threats and opportunities, and I think that's a solid takeaway for today. So, you know, we've run a lot of webinars over the last 2 years, and we've done a lot of presentations on the risk report and so on. And I always ask the question when we do a webinar, it was my sort of pet hobby to ask. So was COVID or is COVID-19 a black swan, or was it just an elephant in the room? And the answer is actually, it's irrelevant for this discussion. The point here that I want to make is that you have to start these conversations on the opportunity that is provided by COVID to start talking about the next COVID-like risks, the climate change, the disruptive technologies, the changing consumer behavior are three examples that I thought pertinent to highlight to you. We need to start getting those onto the agenda at least the audit and risk committees, or if you're fortunate enough to have a focus risk committee, to get that in there. Because believe you me, the pandemic was in the room, was the white elephant for years now. It's been on the World Economic Forum for years. If I'm not mistaken, since 2008, could even be earlier. I say they've even made movies about this. So this cannot be considered a black swan. It is just something that was there that we probably chose not to discuss. And I think with COVID now, we have the leverage, we have the floor space to start bringing in those COVID-like risks that I've used examples of. And then this report, thanks to Walter Ehrlich, we realized that for our country to respond to this risks, the profession needs a more real-time, risk-intelligent contribution that will allow better, faster, and more complex decisions to be made with support of the risk profession. And I mentioned Walter's name because Walter has chapters 4 and 5 in the risk report was all about how do we actually get there. And, as a boardroom bite, I think that's worthwhile looking at to make sure that, one day when you look at your CRO again, that you actually ask those questions about how are we progressing in building a risk intelligent organization, a risk intelligent and resilient organization. I indicated that I just wanted to have a quick chat around why did we, in the presence of Indru Lamiti, Clem Santer, Franz Cronier, people that have already developed scenarios for South Africa? Well, IRMSA thought it was really necessary that we develop scenarios that spoke to the risks that we've identified and to make those links very clear, and then to also provide as part of the risk report a roadmap of maybe not, definitely not an exhaustive roadmap, but serious indicators of what do we believe the risk treatment options could be, what should those options consider, but certainly also what are the challenges that exist in achieving those options. And I think that's why, we built the IRMSA scenarios and we stuck to 3, and we said a scenario that we do not want to be in, but that we are in, is a perpetual hangover. So that's about fighting fires all the time. It's about social bankruptcy. It's about own agendas. It's about us spending money to fill gaps where bankruptcy and corruption and fraud and the like have eroded our capability to run the country properly. And then moving on to a better, but certainly not the optimal state is the notion of we'll fake it until we make it or not, and then we move back into a perpetual hangover. That's where we talk the talk, but we don't walk the walk. I think this is it. So we impress by virtue of what we say we want to achieve, but we hardly ever get to achieve what we set out to do. And then, of course, owning our future. And that is where we end up putting out there the right strategies for our country, and we support those strategies with ethical execution and, of course, performance that resonate with what we set out to achieve. So just wanted to put that into perspective. And why was that important? That is important because the 12 risks that we have identified, and I'm not going to narrate them for you, you can see them there. The 12 risks that we've identified, we've then, and I'm gonna move on briefly now to them, but these 12 risks we've then unpacked as a current risk assessment as we see them currently, and we've indicated that against our scenario model, and then we took the country strategy, the country plan, and we said, given what we know about the risks, given what we know about the risk responses that need time, what does this look like? What could this look like in 2030? And that's the 2030 South Africa strategy or the South Africa performance plan or improvement plan. So the risks that I'm going to spend time talking to you about in the next couple of slides would be about leadership. I want to highlight one or two issues around governance failures, fraud and corruption. I think we need to just say 2 or 3 words about. Then the ones that I think could be the next COVID-like risks, the consumer behavior, or at least the changing consumer behavior. And again, yeah, I need to talk about risk and opportunity. Well, that's technically not correct. It's risk. But risk is all about threats and opportunities. So when we talk about consumer behavior, in that lies threats to some, but certainly a lot of opportunity that we can leverage from. National health system, I've highlighted that, but my talk to that is not the obvious talking about the health system. I want to highlight one or two things that cut across many of the other risks. And that's about where we will have time for. And of course, you will find the next level detail in the risk report, and of course, the slides that are attached to the back. So what is this that I would like to highlight out of the scarcity, or at least the leadership risk, the leadership risk? So let me just introduce my slide. On the left, you'll see the scenarios. Those are the three IRMSA scenarios. Currently, we're pitching this risk as in perpetual hangover, and that's where we do not want to be. So we are looking to at least move into fake it until we make it, and hopefully into owning our future. And that we need to do very, very quickly. Now let me just say, earlier I said we are not ranking our risks. We don't have a number one and a number 12. However, the risk around leadership is the biggest driver in the report. Now, what do I mean when I say driver? A driver means that this risk is identified or exists in its own right. So it is a risk. However, when you look at the narratives around the other 11, and many more, by the way, when you look at the narrative around those, and you look at the causes, you will find that leadership becomes a cause to many, if not all, of those risks. And that cause itself is so pertinent, so significant, that could one address the leadership risk, one would address many other risks, at least in as far as moving them from perpetual hangover into fake it until you make it, or at even into owning our own future. I hope I was quite clear on the reason why this is such an important risk. And then that's the scenario part. Then you'll see the flags part. So we have 10 elements or 10 country flags that we've highlighted, that if you can change your visionary leadership, what would that impact be across the leadership, not just at country level, but all other levels, institutional capacities and the like. And you'll see them there. And of course, you'll read the risk report, and then you'll get a lot more detail around those. And then the very important part, or the cool part, that I think the team that put this report together achieved, was that we have a view on our current risk assessment. Where does the current risk sit? And currently we believe for leadership, it's in perpetual hangover. And then if you look at the treatment options, if you look at the challenges, and one could adopt, and one could apply the South African story to that, we believe that the country strategy by 2030 could potentially look like that. Now, of course, it's a well-informed estimate or a well-informed positioning. Factually, I suppose it could be challenged, but at least it gives us some idea of what we think going forward. So let me leave you with some thoughts around leadership. So leadership in itself, like I said, it's a driver, but of course it's been failing, not just in the public sector, it's been failing in the private sector as well. And my comment earlier that I made around the eyeglass, that the pandemic just amplified or just put the eyeglass onto the impact of not having unified ethical and visionary leadership. I think to go into detail around how the COVID pandemic was dealt with, how the rollout of PPE was handled, and of course then examples in the private sector. Certain companies just flourished. Others have not yet opened their doors. They probably won't. Certain payrolls were kept intact with really ingenuitive decision-making and quick response to reviewing strategy and the like. And others, of course, have not. So I think that was the point around leadership. It's the agility, it's the foresight, and of course, it's the steadfastness of ethical, visionary leadership. And I want to talk a little bit about visionary. Currently, we are in the perpetual hangover because everything is about short-sightedness, everything is about firefighting. And so when we think about stuck in the here and now, and we are not thinking about those socio-political, geopolitical, socio-economic issues that we can't fix in a day, and you don't fix it with one decision. It is a time-consuming risk response strategy. It needs time to happen. And then to ask the question, so which of those decisions are taken with that outcome in mind? Or are they about my own agenda, the hidden agenda, and the like? And that is where visionary links back to ethical, and then of course the term unified. Are we, and I think in our report, the best example that we used there was Sia Khaleesi. I mean, a very, very good example of how leadership, well executed with vision, impacted not just at 15 or 30 odd people winning a trophy, but that impact that it had on a country as a whole. That small example, it feels like, impact that we could have if you can amplify that leadership across the public and the private sector, SMEs for that matter as well. So that was one of the examples we used in the report. I'm conscious of my time because I want to share some other thoughts around this. So what is the one key takeaway for us in this space? One, we should hold our leaders accountable. There should be consequence management. I highlighted that part earlier. We should even go as far as making sure that our legal system could respond to particularly dealing with this because this is something that needs to be dealt with. We, from reflection over the last couple of months, we are dealing with this piecemeal, one person at a time, although we know that fraud and corruption in our country is systemic. It's eroding the social fabric because it's systemic. It is not just odd incidents. And so it will require a lot of intervention there, but that I'll talk to when we get there. So the leadership question around this is we need to take that stance. We need to enable our institutions to be able to deal with those sorts of things. And that only comes from a unified, a ethical, and a visionary leadership, because that means we understand what the impact is on our country when this happens. The pipeline is the next point I just wanted to leave you with here. Question that you should ask yourself in your own capacity, but also looking across the, and I don't want to enter into the political space, but when you look at the pipeline of leadership, it's not just in your organization, in the private or the public sector, it is also about our country. So what does that pipeline look like? Do we have people coming in that we can say and associate with as far as visionary leadership goes, and needless to say, ethical leadership? So that's one of the challenges that we've highlighted. And of course, the resistance to change. The resistance to change. We have been vocal about many things, but we haven't been vocal about the billions of rands that have been eroded out of South Africa. We've actually never stepped up and spoke about that. We have spoken about many other things, and we've gotten physical and vocal about those things. And so the apathy around this does not help. And from that point of view, silence is an indicator of our resistance to change. And that is one of the challenges that whoever comes up with the risk response strategy to deal with this will have to consider. And that what I think that's the value proposition of the risk report, because we highlight those challenges. And again, not the exhaustive list, but the important ones. Okay, so I spent a little bit more time on this slide because I wanted to introduce the slide itself, how to interpret the slide, and then to link it back to when you read the risk report, you will understand, or you will have some insights rather, from how we move from the current view, which in this case is all red, by the way, as if you wouldn't have seen that, moving into the more yellow and green space, which is fake it until we make it and owning our future. And then the last reminder here is considering the points that we made around timing. It is going to require time. This is not a switch on and off situation. It is about making the defining the right strategies and then start executing those strategies so that we can move along our scenario plan path. Okay, so I'm going to then move on to my next one. And having done so, I just want to reflect again. Please keep in mind the word driver, that these are risk drivers that I've highlighted for you. Because yes, they are risks in their own right, but they are also significant causes to other risks that we've identified. Okay, again, we're sitting in the perpetual hangover space on continuing private and public governance failures. But, you know, our current situation doesn't look as bad as the previous slide. Have to say that we would have loved to have seen better progress from current into the 2030s, recognizing that we literally have 7, maybe 8 years left to achieve that. So very important point there. So what are those areas within the public and the governance failure space that we've highlighted? And I think the important thing is that we are not holding these public and private bodies, the boards, the oversight committees, the individuals, we are not holding them accountable. There is no consequence management, or at least we are saying there are no pervasive consequence management that happens. And it's also a point here where one of the recommendations is that we need to capacitate the legal system, the legal enforcement, the skills at that level to be able to deal with this sort of risk, and also the elements that are making up this risk. So from that point of view, we highlighted that in the report as well. And then the issue around skills, that we needed to make sure that people that sit on these bodies that govern, people that set direction, that consider strategy, have adequate skills. And of course, not just having the skills, but executing against those skills. And for that reason, I think the challenge is on the table to say, are we measuring these individuals? Are we measuring the boards, the oversight committees as a collective? Are we measuring them properly? And for that reason, then is the response to that performance measure then in place? Does that match? And I think that is one of the key challenges also that we highlighted. So in essence, it means, are we appointing the right people in the right place? Do they have the right skills? Do we measure them properly? And if we do find that there is a situation or that there is a gap, is our response matching up with what we know about that situation? I think the outcome of not getting this right is the quality of decision-making, is the quality of direction that both public and private companies take. And I think that's the risk causes underlying, or actually consequences, my apology, underlying this risk and the importance of getting this right. Okay, so hoping to move, or at least projecting to move from a current situation into a future situation, that I would have loved to have seen a lot more greens, because getting this right together with the risk around leadership will change a lot. And therefore they are key drivers. Like I said, getting them right impact across the 12 risks that we've identified, and many others for that matter. I want to then, just before I move on, failure to root out and or curb deeply entrenched corruption, the word systemic is what we are worried about. And of course, I've spoken a little bit about capacitating our law enforcement, capacitating the skills in the legislative system, the legislative bodies or departments to be able to deal with this. And maybe it's time that you have at least for this time in our history and future, maybe have very specific structures like they may exist in certain instances that deal with fraud and corruption. Because I did mention it is systemic. It is not clever individuals that achieve this. These are clever individuals that built a system that allows for embedded fraud and corruption in both public and the private sector. So again, spoken about the Chapter 9 institutions, making sure that they are up and running, making sure that they are well equipped. And of course, budget cuts don't help. And there are budget cuts galore, not just because of wanting to be more efficient, but as a result of fraud and corruption, that we do not have the money to do this. And the skills discussion comes back into play, and the numbers discussion comes back into play. So do we have the right people to do the job? Are they skilled up enough? And then to capacitate these bodies to deal with this. And then I want to bring this back again. Apology for keeping doing this, but I think it's so critical, because you'll see this is also a risk in the perpetual hangover space. We need to make sure that we get leadership to focus on these three risks: the leadership risk, the pipeline issue around that, the governance risk, getting the right people in charge, measuring those people to achieve, and then of course the whole idea about eliminating fraud and corruption. And you know what the important thing is? And I think you'll pick it up into the flag space. It impacts tremendously on our social cohesion. It's getting people onto the next level of feeling better about themselves. And once we can get that right, we are emulating what we feel like when we will win the World Cup or we win some arbitrary trophy or, you know, whatever the case may be. Can you imagine if that's how you feel about winning a rugby match, how you would feel about getting your country right? And I think that is what we are after. I just want to make sure that I've thought about all of this. We did speak about the impact of not having the right people, the right money, the right and capacitating the right institutions to respond to this. And of course, holding people, consequence management, holding people responsible. And of course, there will be a lot more information when you read the risk report. So let me move on then to our next slide. And this is something I warned you earlier. I said I brought it in not for the reason that it was written in the risk report. What I want to talk to you about here is indeed the inability, the risk of not being able to, as a country, to respond to mega projects, to deliver on mega projects. And I think the underlying causes and consequences are pretty much the same as what we've spoken about this morning again. So whether we are rolling out a virus, antibody program, an antivirus program, a vaccine program, whether we're rolling out building stadiums in South Africa, building power stations in South Africa, or whether we are rolling out a national health system. Our inability to do this properly has been costing our country billions of rand. And you can pick the examples out there. So this I wanted to bring out, because the underlying risk here, the underlying cause to this risk would be in our inability to deliver on a mega project. Because you can imagine this is a mega project. This is not building a table or building one stadium. This is a complete redo of a national health insurance system, which will impact the country tremendously. So I brought this in to talk about that. I'm running out of time. Shifting consumer behavior, very briefly to highlight here, we've seen it. We've seen it. The three big things that bring consumers into your space would be the fact that your price is right, the fact that you have less hurdles or less barriers to enter or to gain access to your service or to your product. And then lastly, and this is something that's coming to the fore a lot more, and you should know about this, is the customers do not just decide on the first two, they also decide around the innovation that goes into your product and your services, the goodwill that sits behind it when it comes to where does it come from, what is the value chain, where did I source my products from, where were my inputs from, how do I process those inputs, and the outcomes, the product or the service that's delivered, how does that resonate with what we want to achieve globally? Achieve then takes me to the next one, is about our global health and safety, our extreme weather events, our natural disasters, and our climate. And I think that's quite critical. And at this point, you'll see we're also in the perpetual hangover space, and I want to bring your thoughts back into why is it there, and the leverage that we have to use now with on the back of COVID to bring these discussions into the boardrooms, into the oversight committee discussions. Don't make this another white elephant. We need to put this out there. We need to put the changing customer behavior onto the discussion platform, because those are the COVID-like risks that will come back, and we'll ask the same question again. Is it a black swan, or was it a white elephant? And so just closing out on the extreme weather events, the national disasters, and climate change, want to put this into perspective. Why is this going to be such a difficult thing to get right? Because we sit with unofficially close to 50% unemployment. Our structural inequality has not been changed. We talk about all kinds of positions of capital this way and capital that way, but we haven't made a shift. And in that context, how will we then start addressing our climate, the money that it requires, the commitment that it requires, and over and above all, the leadership that it requires, given what we know about the context of our country? And then to close off by saying, please read the report. Please consider those individuals that contributed to the context and hear what they've got to say. Our report is such that you can listen to a couple of videos as well and hear how they put this into perspective. And so with that, we also talk about what are the competencies. I won't be spending too much time on this, but the report then highlights what are these competencies in the risk space that boards need to have, that risk professionals need to have, that leadership needs to have. And then also to say, so IRMSA's call to action, how are we supporting our country? Well, we're focusing on integrating strategy, risk, and resilience. It's not just about risk. It's about thinking the right thinking in setting strategy, executing that strategy, and if something goes wrong, of course, to have resilience in place so that we can survive, but that we are better off afterward. And then adaptiveness and agility, we need that in our space. We need to look at our operating models, our business models. Are they agile enough? Can they adapt quick enough? That the risk register is not the beginning and end of risk, of effective risk management. We need to speak about scenario planning. We need to talk about systems thinking. We need to think about key risk indicators and being able to predict rather than just reflect in a risk register kind of way. Understanding your risk culture and your risk maturity is the fundamental departure point of getting your risk contribution, your risk effectiveness right. And then, of course, leveraging your chief risk officer. Yeah, it is important. And then I'm leaving you with this message that you have to step up, and now is the time. I've seen in the chats that people are asking about where can we get the report. The report can be downloaded by scanning in. The report can be downloaded from the IRMSA web. You've got the link at the bottom. You can scan off this one, of course. If we can achieve that, then you've got the report and you can read the report. Good. Vikeshni, I think at this point where I think you've taken control back, there was one more link, but they are, oh, there we go. That one. Yes, indeed.
Yeah, that one.
Thank you very much. So that's the last slide.
So
and then we can go back.
Yeah, we don't have a lot of time for questions.
Sorry for that.
So I think we'll just do a few questions. And if anyone would like to ask a question live, please raise your hand and I'll unmute you. So unfortunately, we don't have much time. As Chris indicated that he also needs to leave by 10 o'clock before 10, because he's got another webinar at 10 o'clock. So Chris, I don't know if you've seen some of the questions on the Q&A. Is anything in there that has struck you that you'd like to ask, or can I just pick any?
No, I can. I'm seeing Leon Kaplan. I don't know where I'm on the scroll list, but I see Leon Kaplan, unemployed youth. Leon, indeed. Unemployment, the lost generation is dealt with in the risk report. So I'm just going to point you in the direction. I won't spend time talking about those then, Vikeshni, if that's okay. So Leon, you'll find a whole risk allocated to that specifically. Are the country flags listed in any particular order? No. I'm asking this question strictly due to sustainability being a focus area these days. No, they are not. They're not listed in any particular order. The flags are just the flags, and they get interpreted and responded to individually. So it's a divide by 10 rule, if you like. They're equally important, at least from an IRMSA risk report perspective. Oba King, what is consequence management? How different? Well, indeed, consequence management, I suppose, is just the sexy word for saying we need to know what people need to achieve. They need to achieve it in a way that is specified in good corporate governance. And we need to measure what they do, their performance. And should the performance not be in line with the expectation, there needs to be consequence management. So indeed, Oba King, it is the same. The value chain of consequence management is just a little bit longer than just saying that there's a disciplinary process, because there should be reward as well. We should reward good governance. We should reward good leadership. And so hopefully I just helped there. Christopher, my understanding is a risk is an unknown future event. Yes, the effect of uncertainty on objectives. These risks are current realities. Yes, they are. And as you rightly state, drivers of bigger risks. What about the value of the rand? Yes. So you'll see that one of the risks is our economic sustainability. Like I say, they're not ranked particularly in any particular order. I just chose those for today's discussion. So Christian, fully aware of your point, risk is about the uncertainty. So when you read this report, you will have a very different context of interpreting or adapting the report than many other people. And I think that's the value proposition. It won't be a uncertainty for everybody, but it may be for some. You're going to have to adopt and adapt. Okay, Alison, how do we address the risk of lack of skills in governance, particularly in the public sphere, in conjunction with the ANC stated goal of CADA deployment? I think that is where visionary leadership will have to come from, Alison, where those very difficult decisions, where your agenda, what is my agenda? Is my agenda to own our future of our country, or is our agenda one of self-enrichment and self-serving? And I think that all ties back to having visionary, ethical leadership in place. Ricardo de Freitas, from a company that is just starting the risk management process, what tool can best be used to handle all of the risk registers and ensure? Okay, if you say tool, are you referring to a risk management information system or a framework or maybe both? I would like to respond to you, Ricardo, outside of this. My contact details are on the PowerPoint presentation. Please drop me a mail and we can have a conversation around this. Andrew Connold, in the consumer behavior risk, global trends is the only flag that has gone backwards in the future forecast. Why is this? So we are not agile enough. We have not, our policies, for example, do not support this sort of future thinking. We are not agile enough. We are not, our agility, our business operating models. And so a very generic response for you, but just look into the report. You will see some really good examples. And of course, we also give you some success stories in there as well. Vikeshni, let's look at Nivesh, if we can. Am I doing well on the questions, Vikeshni? I'm going.
That's far. Fine. I'm trying to move them or dismiss them as we go. You can do Nivesh, and I think if we have Alison and Godfrey right at the end has some two nice questions. Alison wants to know, how do you raise the profile of risk management in an organization so that the board focuses on proactive management as opposed to reactive reporting? I think that was a good one.
How do we raise the profile of risk management? Okay, I see. So we've skipped a couple. I just want to say Nivesh and Makululi, you will find responses in the risk report referring to both of your questions. Alison, how do you raise the profile of risk management in an organization so that the board's... Yes. So Alison, two responses here. It is all about us stepping up to stop talking about what we want to do and start showing what we want to do. And the biggest change we have to make here is integrating strategy, risk, and resilience. This is not about a risk register, and that is why boards leave us standing outside the boardroom and you get comments like, your report has been taken as read. How do we raise the profile? Well, firstly, COVID has given us a window of opportunity. We should use this now, because I'm hoping that your organization is looking at the risk profession and saying, where have you guys been? You know, why haven't you told us about COVID? And all of a sudden we've got space on the agenda to start talking. We then have to use that space by not just having risk registers, but getting ourselves to talk about scenarios, to bring in our emerging risk radar, to talk about systems thinking, systemic impact of risk management. So aggregating and integrating risk, to have key risk indicators, have a solid, strong, articulated risk appetite ability. And so all of those tools and techniques now need to be put together so that when we have this window to be heard, that we impress and that we turn our organization into a risk intelligent organization. And a risk register will not get you there. We have to do more. In the consumer behavior, global trends, okay, we've answered that one. I invited Andrew just to look in there. The big backdrop for coming back is that the policy framework in South Africa, specifically to how SMEs, our private companies are handled, are enabled, are really lacking. And given the time that's left, I don't think we're going to change. As a matter of fact, we will lose a lot more of those free thinking entrepreneurial skills in the time. Any insights for a company wanting to become risk intelligent? Godfrey, I think I've responded quite a bit on that. Please pay attention to section 5 of the risk report. This is exactly what you're going to find there. I'm hoping there's such a rush, but I do get excited about this. So Vikeshni, back to you then. Thank you.
Thank you, Chris. Unfortunately, everyone, I know we need to stop in time this morning because Chris does have another webinar, but I've just posted in the chat, if those who have put questions in the chat group, if you could please put your questions in the Q&A while we end, and I'll give you a bit of time now as well. We won't close the session until you've managed to do that. We'll give you a few minutes. If you can please put your questions there, we'll then have a record of your questions, and I'll get Chris to just respond to everyone individually with some answers or responses to the questions that you raise, just so that he can attend to all of them and you get some sort of response. I've left the screen on now where you can use the QR code to download the report. It is also available on the IRMSA website. I believe the links have been put in the chat group for you to look at, so you can access them through there. And if you would like Chris's details, here are his details, his email address that you can take down, and you can possibly send him any additional questions that you may have there. But we will definitely send him the Q&A questions that have been posed, and specifically those that have not been answered. we will share with him to email you individually. So with that, thank you very much for joining us this morning. It was a very lengthy session with a lot of information. And we will hopefully have Chris again, I'm sure, to talk more about risk. He has been on before. And we will then look forward to next week's session as well, which I believe is on COSEC challenges. So for now, goodbye. And I will stay on for a bit to allow everyone to put their questions in the Q&A. Thank you for joining us.